In this lecture segment, we're going to start taking a little deeper look at some of the basic ideas of object-oriented programming. Okay, let's get started. As we probably said in passing earlier, object-oriented programming, or OOP, represents a new, more modern way of looking at software. In earlier languages, or in decades past, programming was a lot more focused on linear, procedural programming. Programs tended to be larger, longer sets of instructions, perhaps carved up into smaller parts called functions or procedures. But as it turns out, large monolithic programs such as these are difficult to adapt or to reuse. Think of an old-style program as being a large, mature tree. It might work fine just where it is, but now think about uprooting that tree and trying to transplant it somewhere else. Or maybe you're removing one or more of its branches to use it someplace else. Not so easy, right? It's not really amenable to such change or modification. Object-oriented programming seeks to improve on this situation. In OOP, everything, and I mean everything, is an object. As we said before, an object is a software representation of some real-world thing. On the first day of class, we drew the analogy of objects as reusable software Lego building blocks. And furthermore, objects themselves can be made up of other objects in some hierarchical fashion. By viewing the world, or more specifically software, in terms of such modular objects, we take a big step towards making our programs much more easy to write and maintain. There are two central yet complementary ideas in object-oriented programming: classes and objects. Classes represent the general. They are software templates or containers which collect together the two types of information which describe some real-world object: the data that describe that object and all the methods which tell it what that object can do. Using a class as our template or blueprint, we can use it to originate any number of new objects, as shown in this figure on the right. Objects, by contrast, represent the specific. They are the new things created using the class template in a process called instantiation, and we refer to an object as being an instance of a class. Every new object of the class has the same properties but distinct values for them. Let's take a look at some examples of this. Again, classes and objects are the two dual fundamental ideas of object-oriented programming. Classes are the general, or the blueprints, whereas objects are the specific instances. So for example, I live out in West Roseville, where there's been lots of construction going on in recent years. In my bike rides around town, I see lots of homes and schools which look alike. A builder might use the same blueprint to construct numerous new houses which look alike, but every one has a unique address, color scheme, and landscape design. The school district might use a common elementary school plan to stand up lots of new schools, but each one has its own principal, staff and student rosters, and mascot. My wife enjoys baking with our two kids. Together they can stamp out lots of cookies with each cookie cutter, but each one might have its own dough flavor, frosting, and decorations, and so on. Well, I think you get the general idea. We've already talked about a class in terms of what it is and what it does. Here's a summary of those distinctions. In formal Java terms, the data which describe the class is referred to as its fields or instance variables, and the things that a class does are called its methods. We can more informally think of these as a class's attributes versus its behaviors, or its descriptions versus its actions. Even more informally, we can think of the fields of a class as being its nouns or adjectives, and its methods as being its verbs. Also, when we think about what a class does, note that takes into account both what the class can do and what can be done to the class itself. Let's take a look at some examples. Here's a table which shows several hypothetical classes and some sample attributes and behaviors of them. I won't bore you by reading through this entire table. You can take a look at it yourself. But this gives some concrete examples of what you might find inside a class description. For example, in this first row, a person might be described by their first and last names, their date of birth, their height and weight, and so forth. Some typical person behaviors might be to eat, sleep, walk, and so on. And you can take a look at these other classes as well. Note that there aren't necessarily any right or wrong descriptions to these classes. It's all up to the discretion of the designer as to what they think accurately or adequately describes a class. But these examples should give you a concrete idea of how some real-world things might be described as software classes. Again, what a class is and what a class does. We've already seen this diagram several times now, but as a reminder, this is a UML class diagram. It's a standard representation of some software class. In the top pane, we'll see the name of the class, which by well-established Java convention always begins with a capital letter. In the middle pane are the fields of the class, and in the bottom pane are the methods of the class. Writing classes like this, when we begin to design them, lets us focus on the general aspects of the class without having to worry about any of their implementation details just yet. The process of describing classes like this is sometimes referred to as object modeling. One of the nice features about object-oriented programming is the idea of modularity, the idea that everything we need to know about an object is fully self-contained within that object. In OOP, we frequently refer to this as encapsulation. For example, have you ever built a piece of IKEA furniture? Everything you need to build, say, a bookcase object, is self-contained within that one IKEA box. All the parts and tools needed, or the data, and all the needed assembly instructions, or the methods. Ever need to have a service call from a plumber or an electrician? Hopefully everything needed to address your particular emergency is contained in that service truck. Spare parts and tools, or the data, and all the needed technical expertise to wield that stuff, or the methods. These may be somewhat imperfect analogies, but hopefully this gets across the idea of encapsulation. Finally, the big advantage of object-oriented programming is the idea of code reuse. If we construct a new application out of a series of individual classes from the get-go, we reap some big benefits downstream. If we've written our classes well from the start, we can take them and reuse them in new settings. This saves on future development effort because we no longer need to reinvent the wheel by rewriting that code. Future applications we write are more robust because they're written using existing components that have already been shaken out. If we need to make some changes for later needs, we can tweak existing components rather than rewrite our entire application. For example, if we want to spruce up our house for sale, we put on a fresh coat of paint rather than rebuild the entire house. And finally, by its very nature, software is always being upgraded and enhanced. By designing our software in modular fashion from the beginning, we can more easily extend or adapt it to meet new opportunities. Okay, that's the end of this introduction to object orientation. We'll pick back up by beginning with an overview of Java itself.